I'm not the kind of person who takes trigger warnings particularly seriously. In fact, in our house, they're a little bit of a joke that Mrs. Cookin makes when we're watching Netflix and they pop up, "Oh, you're gonna really enjoy this film, it has all of your favourites." And believe me when I tell you that if you are of a nervous and anxious disposition, especially about the way the world is going and civilization in general, then turn this video off and forget that you ever heard a movie called Threads exists, because I think this is the most realistic, terrifying, brutal and harrowing depiction of nuclear war and its aftermath that has ever been put to film. It makes that scene in Terminator 2, or Terminator, where everybody gets fried by a nuclear bomb, look like Disney on Ice in comparison. In fact, halfway through this, I had to turn it off and go for a walk because I could feel myself getting physically tense. There are a lot of narrative, social, and political threads throughout this film that are still sadly very relevant even now, 40 years almost after its release. So with that all being said, let's just jump in straight to the review. Threads is a 1984 British made-for-TV apocalyptic war drama produced by the BBC and Nine Network and written by my hometown boy Barry Hines, who excelled at writing these hard-hitting Northern English working-class dramas, along with the excellent novel and film Cares, which is only one of two films I know of which is actually set in my hometown and will definitely be appearing on this channel at some stage because it's one of the greatest films ever made. Threads is however set in that dank cesspit a mere 12 miles down the M1 from where I grew up, Sheffield. The narrative here is part fictional drama and part quasi-documentary told in three distinct parts. The build-up, which is on the surface a family kitchen sink drama, but in reality where the actual real drama lurks in radio and TV broadcasts in the background. The actual nuclear attack and its immediate brutal and harrowing effects, with a narrator now interjecting increasingly to give documentary style facts and figures. Then the even more depressingly brutal and equally harrowing aftermath and collapse of society from the very opening scene where we meet our erstwhile protagonists, Ruth and Jimmy. It is obvious this film is going for as much realism as possible, because if you listen very carefully to the radio news broadcast in the background, you can hear that my beloved Barnsley Football Club have in fact managed to lose 2-1 away to Fulham. Even in a fictional setting, we are utter shy. Just after this shocking reality-shaped bombshell, we find out that Ruth is pregnant. It's unplanned, but her and Jimmy plan to marry each other because they were going to get engaged anyway, and that's kind of what was expected of people back then, I guess. What follows is them planning their future lives together, worries over their parents meeting each other, buying a house, and what renovations they will do to it, etc. Quickly followed by Jimmy having one last go on a different bike, if you get my drift, because also probably expected back then. Everyday relatable family dramas that are as old as time and will probably last as long as civilization does. Spoiler, it isn't lasting long enough for the baby to arrive. This is merely a foreground distraction to the real drama happening in the background, with TV and radio news reports outlining an escalating conflict between Russia and the United States over Iran, which as I write this is about as relevant as it gets, with NATO and Russia holding an international dick-swinging contest over Ukraine in a situation that could turn deadly any day now. Over the course of this escalating conflict, we are shown snippets of government and civilian preparation for nuclear war. Now, to put this bluntly, once the nuclear attack occurs, which is the second part of Fred's narrative, it doesn't matter how prepared or ill-prepared for it you are, in no uncertain terms, you are right royally fucked. As Jimmy's mother says after half her face was melted off and she has suffered days of radiation sickness.
Emma.
Oh, I wish I were dead. Wish it were me.
Not to worry anyone or anything, because seriously, if this film's depiction of the Cold War going hot is to be believed, the only thing worse than a nuclear attack is actually surviving one. The blast and its effects, I genuinely think, are probably the closest anyone has ever gotten to actually depicting nuclear war and its aftermath, and this isn't a coincidence, with the director Mick Jackson having set out to do exactly that. He travelled extensively around the UK and US to consult with experts, and used various scientific and government reports on the expected results of nuclear war on Britain, then turned those into threads. In 1984, this was a very real and present danger we lived with. It wasn't some crazy, far-fetched fiction, so I dread to think the effect this had on people when it originally aired. I'm not joking either when I said I had to turn this off and go for a walk because I was getting physically tense watching this. I was born and grew up not far away from Sheffield, and I've driven over the Tinsley Viaduct probably 1,000 times, which is the place the third nuke strikes. I even worked next to the council buildings for a summer and ate my lunch outside them pretty much every day, so maybe it affected me slightly more than most, I don't know. It's not graphically scary, but psychologically so, which I think is way more effective than gore or graphic violence ever could be. As Jackson himself has said about threads, I made an effort to leave some things unseen, to let images and emotion happen in people's minds, or rather in the extensions of their imaginations. The special effects that realise this horror are surprisingly good for the budget of £400,000 and the era it was made, with a combination of practical effects, composite shots, miniatures and stock footage all being used to terrifying effect. Just as you think the pit in your stomach couldn't get any deeper, the absolute collapse of civilization is depicted, and the psychological traumas of just surviving one more day has on the populace. As the narrator says,
"In the grim economics of the aftermath, there are two harsh realities. A survivor who can work gets more food than one who can't, and the more who die, the more food is left for the rest."
The government's ineffectual response and attempts to restore order, and people's selfish reaction to the crisis, are also sadly very relevant today, what with the pandemic of the last 2 years, and the reaction to that from some quarters and some governments. At one point, an old man turns Ruth out of his house after she's placed there by a policeman, because he doesn't want any strangers in his house, even though most of Sheffield is rubble and his house is relatively unscathed. It's unrelentingly brutal in its depiction. Then Ruth has a baby, cause let's not forget she is pregnant. Jimmy, sadly incinerated in the initial blasts, is no longer alive. His parents died from radiation sickness and burns, and her parents bludgeoned to death by looters. Jane, her daughter, grows up to speak a sort of pidgin English, which sounded remarkably like what people in Sheffield usually sound like to me, but I digress. Then, if this wasn't bleak enough, Ruth dies due to the effects of radiation, poor diet, and an increase in the sun's UV levels due to damage to the ozone layer. Jane impassionately strips her mother's corpse of anything remotely valuable and leaves her dead body laying in her bed. If all that wasn't enough, she's then raped after stealing food, which is still 13 years after the attack scarce, and gives birth to a small child who neither moves nor cries, and we end on a freeze frame of Jane just screaming, which at this point is what you will be doing internally after what must be the most brutal 1 hour and 52 minute runtime I've sat through multiple times. I've seen some people criticise the last third for being too fragmented a narrative, and that it doesn't delve into what the international response to the attacks were. Although yes, this is actually true, I think these people miss the point. The narrative is that way because society is. Everyone we met in Act 1 is now dead or dying, the government has collapsed, money is worthless, food is the only real currency, electricity is non-existent, fuel gone, food as scarce and hard to find as a competent Tory MP. The lack of any news about an international response and the utter devastation of British society rather suggests that there wasn't one. Human civilization as we know it has collapsed, utterly and terrifyingly so, everywhere. So that was Threads. Some of the best kind of filmmaking, because it's not just entertaining, it also hits you on a visceral emotional level, and stays with you for days after, even if you probably wish it didn't. It's terrifying in its stark, vividly realistic depiction of the collapse of civilization. And the most terrifying thing about it is those same social, political and narrative threads it was pulling on 40 years ago are still as relevant now as they were then. But this makes it a very hard film to recommend to anyone, even though you really want to recommend it to everyone. Like, comment and subscribe if you enjoyed that, because next week I'm doing a video on the history of special effects.